start with the understanding about digestive system. I think this is the easiest system to understand because every day we eat 3 times a day, and we very often talk about the digestive system and our digestion and our stomach. So in general, we know a few things about the digestive system, but then what happens internally, that's the thing which is most important to understand. Now, the food, what we consume, any food which we consume, that food cannot be used by the body cells for energy production. Like the food what we consume is too complex. The structure of the food we are talking of, the chemical structure of the food is too complex for the body cells to generate energy out of it. In the other session, we said that the cells, each and every cell in our body produces the energy. But then for this production of energy, the cells, they need the fuel. And this fuel is through the food. But as I said just a couple of minutes back, this food is too complex for the cells to use for energy production. So this complex food is broken down into simple form. And this is the process of digestion. So a complex substance, a complex food, for example, carbohydrate. I think everyone is aware of this term, carbohydrates. We say, oh, we consume carbs. But then carbohydrates, they are very complex in their structure. So they need to be broken down into smaller structure, which is, for example, glucose. I think everyone knows glucose. So if you are just having less energy, you will have a glucose drink and immediately you are having energy, because glucose doesn't need digestion. It's the simple form of food which doesn't need digestion. So carbohydrates are complex and glucose is a simple form. So carbohydrates will be converted into glucose, for example. So this is the process of digestion. And this process involves two parts. One is a chemical process and one is a mechanical or physical process. Like, for example, chewing the food. It's a mechanical process, it's a physical process where we break down the food physically into smaller particles. And when it goes into the stomach, we break down the food into smaller particles at a chemical level. The complex chemicals are converted into simple chemical form. So in short, we can say digestion is a chemical and mechanical process. So that whatever food we have consumed, it can be utilized by the body cells. Of course, for energy production. Now, digestion is one of the most important functions carried out by the digestive system. But then apart from that, you have a list in front of you. The process or the functions of digestive system, they are not only digestion. It starts from ingestion. For example, ingestion means to consume, to eat the food. Then we chew the food properly. After chewing the food, then we swallow it down. Once we swallow it down, then it gets into the stomach and then the process of digestion, it starts. Once the process of digestion is started, or once the process of digestion is finished, this digested food, it needs to enter in your blood, absorption. Because if it remains in the digestive system, it's of no use. It should enter into your blood circulation, and from the blood circulation, it should go to your cells. So the process of absorption. And lastly, whatever food you have not digested, or sometimes you eat something extra, you like a few things and you just eat more than needed. So what is to be done with this food? That's an excess food. So that excess food will be just thrown out of the body. Undigested food will be just thrown out of the body, which is called as excretion. So these all processes, they are carried out in the digestive system. Ingestion, that's consumption of food. Then chewing the food, swallowing the food, digesting it, then absorbing the food, and in the end, throwing out the remaining food, unwanted, undigested food, which is called as excretion. Now, for this whole process, we need some organs, we need some specialized organs, and the organs in the digestive system, the list is in front of you. It starts from the mouth and ends at the rectum. Now, this digestive system, you can say it's a digestive tract which is nearly 32 feet long. So the length is quite large. It's 32 feet long from the mouth till the last point, the excretory point, the rectum. So the length is quite long. The food has to cover this distance of 32 feet. So it starts with the mouth, then there is a part which is called as the esophagus, then it's the stomach, the small intestines and the large intestines. All this together, it is around 32 feet. So if you just need to have a diagrammatic representation, this is how the digestive system looks like. So starting from the mouth, you can see the tube which is coming down, it's the esophagus, then a bulged portion on the left side, a little bit on the left side of our body, which is the stomach. The stomach continues into small intestine, the coils which you can see in the center, they are the small intestine. And the outside one which you see on the right side, it starts on the right side coming up, then from the right side to the left side, and from the left side again it comes down, that's the colon. Or the large intestine, you can say. So the small intestine connected with the large intestine. So this is how the food is going to go through the digestive system. One more thing which you can see in the picture is a triangular structure on the right side of the body. That triangular structure is the very well known structure called as the liver. So I think this word is also familiar with everyone, the liver. So that's the triangular structure which you can see on the right side. So again, to repeat, it's the mouth, the esophagus, the stomach, the small intestine, the large intestine, a single continuous tube, and on the right side what you can see is the liver. Now part by part we'll just try to understand the function of each and every organ. So starting with the mouth itself, obviously in the mouth we have teeth, so the main function in the mouth is chewing, or especially in human beings I would say it is grinding of the food. We grind the food because human beings, we have very strong molar teeth, the side ones, they are very strong, so you can actually grind the food. That's the main difference between maybe human beings and the other animals, or especially I would say the animals who eat meat. For those animals, the front two teeth, canines you can say them, for example the dog or even a cat, tigers and lions, those front teeth, two front teeth, they are sharp so that they can tear off the flesh. But we don't have these teeth very sharp, we have strong molars. So the basic food I would say for human beings is maybe fruits and vegetables, or vegetarian food, that's what we can say roughly, because of the structure of the jaws. So chewing is one of the most important functions of in the mouth. And it is interestingly said that you should chew the food properly if you need the digestion to carry out properly. So Ayurveda, it goes to saying to an extent that you should actually drink solids. I'm saying drink solids and chew the liquids properly. Something weird, huh? Drink the solids and chew the liquids properly. What does that mean? It means that when you have solid food in your mouth, you go on chewing it for so long time that the saliva, the liquid which is secreted in our mouth, the watery liquid, that watery liquid, the saliva, it mixes with the solid food, and that solid food is converted into a liquid or a semi-solid, and then you swallow it. So chewing the food is very, very important, so that you mix the saliva, you mix the watery secretion in our mouth with the food. And on the other hand, what I said, chew the liquids nicely, chew the liquids properly. How you can chew a liquid? Just imagine when you drink water, how do you drink that? You just take the water bottle, put it to your mouth and gulp it down. The water hardly remains in your mouth. So no chance that the water is mixed with the saliva. Just try to remember, when you drink juices, just gulp it down. When you are drinking soup, just gulp it down. So it hardly gives any time for the saliva to be mixed with that juices, maybe soup or water, whatever you are drinking, because it doesn't remain in your mouth. It directly goes down. You swallow it down. So you should keep the liquids in your mouth for some time and then swallow it. So sip by sip, that's the proper way of drinking liquids. a very good example I can give you, but not a good example from a yogic point of view, but then you will quickly understand what I mean by drinking the liquids properly. I can see a smile on few faces. You know the example, it's wine, right? So how you drink the wine? You take a sip, and then what you say the proper word is swirl it around the mouth, right? So it should touch all the parts of the mouth and then you swallow it. But then why don't you do the same thing when you are drinking water? Why don't you do the same thing when you are drinking juices? Why don't you do the same thing when you are having some soup? So I would say liquids, swirl them around the mouth and then swallow them. Very important. Just don't go on gulping it down. Now, what is the significance? That's important. Saliva, yes, it's a digestive juice, so it can help you to digest the food nearly 5 to 10% in the mouth itself. Whatever food you are eating, if you go on chewing it for a long time, nearly 5 to 10% of that food can be digested in your mouth itself. So that when it goes down to the stomach, the digestion has already started in the mouth. If you don't chew it properly, it directly gets into the stomach and the digestion starts in the stomach. So you can start the digestion in the mouth by chewing the food properly. So that's important. And another important function of the saliva is it's an antibacterial. Antibiotics, I think everyone knows this word antibiotics. So if you have an infection, you take an antibiotic. So similarly, our saliva is an antibiotic, it's an antibacterial. Whatever precautions, whatever hygienic conditions you prepare the food, still some microorganisms, they grow in the food. Because it's food, so microorganisms also love it. So some microorganisms definitely, they grow in the food, whatever precaution you take. So that microorganisms, they can be actually killed in your mouth itself if you chew the food properly. Because our saliva is antibacterial. So chewing the food is very important. Then after chewing the food, it gets it down into the part, the tube which you can see, it's the esophagus. A small tube connecting from the throat to the stomach. So there is no digestion, no absorption, no secretion, nothing in the esophagus. The only function of the esophagus is to carry the food from the throat to the stomach. So there is no absorption, no digestion, no secretion, nothing as such in the esophagus. It takes hardly a few seconds for the food to go from the throat to the stomach. Now, once the food enters in the stomach, it remains in the stomach for nearly 3 hours, 3.5 hours, depending on what kind of food you have consumed. But then on an average, it's 3 or 3.5 hours the food will remain in the stomach. And the main process of digestion will be carried out in the stomach. So during these 3 hours, the blood circulation towards the stomach is increased. There is one simple basic principle in our body that whatever organ is functioning more, the blood circulation to that organ is increased. So when the food is inside the stomach, the process of digestion going on, at that time, the blood circulation towards the stomach, the blood flow towards the stomach is increased. So immediately after food, maybe around 3 hours, the blood circulation towards the stomach is more as compared to the other organs of the body. So one of the rules for yogic practices, you might have been told about it, that yoga practice is to be done on an empty stomach. Yoga is not to be practiced immediately after food. The reason is what we are discussing right now. If you start yoga practice immediately after food, it's a muscular action, muscular movements. So the blood circulation, instead of going towards your stomach, it will start flowing towards the muscles because you are becoming physically active. So the stomach will not get enough blood circulation, enough blood supply for the process of digestion. So the process of digestion will be disturbed. You may suffer from indigestion. So yoga practices are to be done definitely on an empty stomach. I've been visiting a few countries, and in some countries I have seen that there are like some yoga classes, and they actually call them as lunchtime yoga. like there is a 2 hours break in some offices. I have seen that there is a 2 hours break for lunchtime, and then within first 15 minutes they will hurriedly just gulp down some lunch and then they will go for a yoga class. That's absolutely a wrong thing to be done. Do not practice yoga when you have food in your stomach, because over a period of time you will suffer from various stomach problems. Not within a day or two, definitely not within a day or two, but over a period of time you will suffer from various stomach ailments which may not be cured. So yoga practice, minimum wait for 3 hours after your food and then you can practice yoga. So the best time would be early morning practice. When you go back home, daily practice of yoga, early morning the stomach is almost empty, so you can practice yoga. Same thing about fluids, about liquids. You had a glass of juice, for example, or you had an energy drink, for example. Then maybe wait for 45 minutes and then you can practice yoga. Because juices or maybe energy drinks or soups, they don't require long time for digestion. They would be just digested within half an hour, maybe 45 minutes. So if you had a glass of juice, for example, or liquid, wait for 45 minutes and then practice yoga. The same I would continue further is with water consumption. Like many a times, even during a yoga class, many students are in the habit of carrying the water bottle and drinking water even during a yoga class. I would not recommend drinking water during a yoga class, especially when we are talking about the traditional yoga. Slowness, steadiness, comfort, relaxation, all these kind of things. In that conditions, definitely you don't need water during your 1 hour class or maybe 90 minutes class. Hardly you need any water. People actually, I have seen people making an assessment of their yoga class on the quantity of water they have consumed. Like they will carry a water bottle and then on that quantity they say, oh, today I didn't drink water too much during the class, so the class was not strong enough. And if they empty their water bottle, then they are very happy. Oh, yesterday the yoga class was very strong. I drank so much of water. It was so strong and so much sweating. But that's not the criteria to judge your yoga class. If you feel thirsty, I would say just sip on the water. Just one or two sips. Like sometimes it may happen that the mouth, it gets dry during the yoga practice. Sometimes possible. But then that doesn't mean that you are totally dehydrated. Dryness of mouth is not dehydration, because this misuse, we use this word dehydration in a very wrong way. So if you just feel some dryness in the mouth, dryness of the tongue, dryness of the lips, then you can just take a sip of water to keep the moisture. But don't go on drinking large quantities. That's what I would suggest. Because liquids, especially, for example, when you have the stomach liquids in your stomach, the stomach will expand, it will increase in size. It's an elastic bag. So when the liquid enters inside, the muscles will grow up in size and they will expand. So now just imagine if I give you a balloon, a simple balloon, and you fill up some water in that and you go on squeezing the balloon from outside, what would happen? Obviously, the balloon may burst open. But same thing about our stomach. It's a balloon. You can see it here in the picture. It's like a balloon. Inside that you have the liquids, or inside that you have the fluid. And then what you are doing, you are actually churning it, or you are actually pressing it, compressing it from outside. In yoga practice, what you'll be doing? Forward bend, backward bend, twisting, turning, all those things. What you are doing? The full balloon, you are actually just churning it from outside. The stomach will not burst open. It's not that weak. The stomach will not burst open. But then over a period of time, you will start having troubles related with stomach and digestion. So see to it definitely that you practice yoga on an empty stomach. It's very, very important. Then a few things which are not related with yoga, but then I would say they are related with the lifestyle. You can call it as a yogic lifestyle. One very important thing is that you should not practice yoga immediately after food. That's true. Another thing is also very important, that you should not sleep immediately after food. That also is a problem. So you eat your food and you go to sleep for 1 hour, 2 hours, just snoring around in the afternoon. That's not recommended. Because when you sleep, all the systems in our body, they slow down. And similarly, the digestion also slows down. So if you go to sleep immediately after food, your digestion will slow down, which takes 3 hours. Maybe it takes 4 hours or 5 hours for the process of digestion. So sleeping immediately after food is not recommended. Maybe you are not sleeping in the afternoon, but in the evening after dinner, most of us, we have dinner back home. I'm not talking here. Back home, we will have dinner sometime at 10 o'clock, 10:30 or something like that, and just immediately go to bed at 11 o'clock. So that definitely needs to be avoided. You need to have your dinner times earlier. Give at least 3 hours before going to bed. Ayurveda actually has recommended to lie down on your left side. Immediately after food, especially in the afternoons, when you have food, you can lie down on your left side. Especially why left side has been recommended, because when you lie down on the left side, it stimulates the breathing through the right nostril. It's a practical thing. You'll be having separate sessions about it, the nostrils and the effects and other things. But then it's an observation that when you lie down on your left side, 15-20 minutes, it's lying down, it's not sleeping. Lying down on left side for 10-15 minutes, the right nostril is activated. And this right nostril is the Surya Nadi, or it's a principle which will heat up the body. Not actually increase the temperature, but that's a different concept in yoga. It's a Agni, you can say, a fire. It will stimulate the fire in your body, or especially the stomach. And digestion, the process of digestion is related with the fire element. So when you start breathing in through the right nostril, the fire element will be further stimulated and the process of digestion will improve. So lying down on left side is recommended, but no sleeping. Sleeping is definitely to be avoided. Then next, once the process of digestion is completed, 3 hours, maybe around 3 hours, the process of digestion is completed. The food, now it's not food actually, it's a liquid, because it has been mixed with saliva, it has been mixed with digestive enzymes from your stomach. So it's more or less liquid, and this liquid now enters into the small intestine. Now it slowly flows through the small intestine, and from the small intestine, this food or the digested food is absorbed in our blood. So it will actually enter the food, or now it's actually the liquid that will enter in our blood. This is the process, what we said was the process of absorption. So you absorb the food inside your blood. Now once the food enters in your blood, from the blood it directly goes to the liver. It will nowhere go in your body. From the small intestine, it enters into the blood, and from the blood, there is a special connection, I can say, or there is a super express highway directly from the small intestine in the blood, and from the blood directly to the liver. And in the liver, the main function, again, one more main function which is carried out, is to check the quality of the food. Whatever food you have consumed, the tongue just checks the taste. You feel the tasty food and you eat more, but then the liver checks the quality, whether it's good or bad for the body. And so the main function is quality checking in the liver. Each and every particle, each and every molecule of the food will be checked for its quality. If the food is bad quality, if the liver feels that this food is toxic, this food will cause harm to the body, then the liver starts the process of detoxification. A very popular word nowadays. Many of you, I think you might have gone to detoxification retreats. So you pay a few $100 and you drink some herbal things, and they, after 7 days, you say, oh, I am detoxified. But then that detoxification process is carried out daily basis in our liver. So the food being checked, if it is toxic, it's detoxified by the liver, it is destroyed by the liver. and the good quality food, the good particles of the food, they will further be sent to the body cells for energy production. This example, I can give you an example, and again an example which is not a good example to talk of in yoga class, but then everyone will understand what is this detoxification process. Alcoholism, everyone knows it. So the first effect of alcohol, everyone is aware, it's on the liver. So first there will be maybe enlargement of liver, then cirrhosis of liver, failure of liver, and many, many, many things. Why this happens? Because you drink alcohol, it goes to the liver says it's a bad thing, tries to destroy it. So detoxification of alcohol in the liver, but you don't stop, you again have another glass of alcohol, again the same process, the liver says it's a bad thing, try to detoxify. And you go on consuming alcohol in large quantities, and a point comes when the liver, it gives up. I can't handle this much quantities of alcohol, I'm not made to handle so large quantities of alcohol. So the liver goes into a failure, maybe enlargement, failure, cirrhosis, and other things. So in our day-to-day life also, it's not necessary that it's only alcohol which is damaging the liver. In our day-to-day life also, there are many things which can damage the liver. For example, preservatives. Simple thing, in our food we have too many preservatives, maybe the coloring agents, the flavoring agents in the food. We have some specific flavors for the ketchups and jams and jellies, right? So that flavors, that colors, and of course preservatives. You can keep the food in your refrigerator for 2 years, the expiry date is for 2 years, so you just keep the jam or jelly in your refrigerator for 2 years and go on eating that. So that preservatives, they are identified by the liver as toxic to the body. So in our day-to-day food also, we are consuming these toxic substances. So you need to minimize the quantity of preservatives, coloring agents, and flavoring agents in your food. So always it's said that eat fresh food, but then there is also a question mark on really the food which you get, is it real fresh, or maybe it's preserved for last 10-15 days. Even the fruits also nowadays, maybe they are refrigerated for 10 days and shipped from one continent to another continent. Then as far as possible, try to eat fresh food, minimum of chemicals in your food, minimum of preservatives in your food, because it will increase the workload on your liver. Now the next process is quite simple. From the digestive system, from the small intestines, now the food is absorbed in the blood. So what remains in the digestive system, what remains in the small intestine, is basically the unwanted food, the food which was not digested, or the food which is an excess of food that will remain into the small intestines, and slowly from the small intestines it would be entering into the large intestines. So from the small intestine it will get into the large intestine. So in the large intestine, it's mainly the unwanted food substances which the body needs to throw out of the body. So at a given time, or when the food is accumulated, when the waste food is accumulated into the large intestines in large quantities, at that time a signal will be sent to the brain, and the brain will empty the bowels. It will just throw away the unwanted, undigested food outside the body. So the function of large intestine is temporary accumulation of the unwanted or waste food, and then removing the waste food out of the body. But then, as I said earlier, it is a 32 feet long digestive system, and for this whole process what we talked, the consuming of food, then digestion, absorption, and throwing out of the food. So the whole process, consuming the food, digesting the food, absorbing the food, and throwing out the waste products outside the body, it takes around 16 to 18 hours. I'm just giving you the time duration to emphasize that 24 hours a day, our digestive system is functional. It will never rest. 24 hours a day, the function is going on. Say today morning, we had breakfast. So it's going to take 16 to 18 hours for the whole process to go on. But before that 16 to 18 hours, again, what we are going to do? Again, lunch. So after lunch, again, it will take 16 to 18 hours. But then before those 16 to 18 hours are completed, in the evening we'll have dinner, maybe afternoon snacks or maybe evening dinner. So it's a cyclical process, and always throughout the day and night, 24 hours, the digestive system is functional. Somewhere or the other, we always have the functions going on. So if you have to give rest to the digestive system, then the way out is fasting. And fasting is recommended for resting of the digestive system and for carrying out the repairing work, the maintenance work of your digestive system. You want to replace some cells, you want to just heal up some injuries inside the digestive system, because we eat all sorts of things, they can cause even injuries inside. So all this healing process for the digestive system, you need to give rest to the digestive system. So if you need to give rest to the digestive system, obviously one of the way out is fasting. And this fasting, now it's of different types, I would say. Some people, they just go for fruit fasting, some people they do water fasting, some people they go for juice fasting, or some people they don't eat and drink at all for one day or so. And the time also depends, the time also varies. Some people, they say, oh, I can fast for 3 days, and other people, they say, oh, I can fast for 7 days. So what's the right thing and what's the wrong thing? There is no criteria for that, but it depends on your own capacities, how long you can fast. So we here, or Guruji at the therapy center, has designed a very simple fasting process, which can be carried out by each and every individual. Now this fasting is good for your digestive system. This fasting is also good for if you are interested in balancing your metabolism, and at the same time, it helps you to clean up your metabolism. Now, this fasting, it's a controlled fasting, I would say, which is for 3 days. I'll just give you the guidelines how you can go around with the fasting. So it's a total 3 days of fasting. So in that 3 days, on day one, you need to eat only raw fruits and vegetables. It's just fruits and vegetables, raw. So you can eat as much quantity as you want. There is no restriction on the quantity of fruits, or there is no restriction on the quantity of vegetables which you can eat raw. You can eat salads, no problem. When I say salads, it actually means only salads without dressings. Otherwise, you would add some cream, some olive oil, and that thing, it's not allowed. It's salad is only salad with no dressings. Dry fruits are not allowed. I repeat, dry fruits are not allowed. Almonds and cashews and all those things, not allowed. And one more thing which is not allowed, or a few more things which are not allowed: no grapes, no mangoes, and no bananas. I repeat, no grapes, no mango, no banana. The main fruits have gone. But then why no grapes, no mango, no banana? The answer is very simple. It has large quantities of sugar. It is large calorie food. You want to give rest to your digestive system. You don't want to go on with digestion. So this large calorie food, you don't want it. So no mango, no banana, no grapes. To this list, I would say this is an incomplete list. To this list, you can add the fruits which are available locally in your country, because I am not aware of the fruits throughout the world. So locally, if you know, okay, this is the fruit in my country especially, and you know that this is a very sweet, high calorie food, high calorie fruit, don't eat that. So fruits and vegetables throughout the day. But when I say throughout the day, it doesn't mean that every 1 hour or every half an hour you eat some fruit. You should have a specific timing of consuming it. Say for example, at the time of breakfast, at the time of lunch, maybe at the time of afternoon snack and evening dinner time. Sit at one place and eat as much as you want. Don't go on eating throughout the day, munching throughout the day, don't do that. Eat at specific times, maybe 3 times or 4 times depending on your appetite. Sit at one place and consume the raw food. So that's day one. If you feel like you can drink water throughout the day, there is no restriction on drinking water. But obviously no tea, coffee and other kind of things. So water, you can drink plain water, no problem. So after day one, you go for day two and it is lemon water. So have some water, warm water, preferred warm water. Squeeze the lemon in it and maybe a pinch of rock salt or maybe natural salt if available. So it's just lemon water throughout the day. On the second day, no fruits, no juices, no eating, nothing. It's only lemon water. How much lemon to be squeezed in how much quantity of water, as such there is no rule for it. It depends on your own taste. So it's lemon water and preferably it's warm water, so that you don't waste energy in warming up the water when it gets into your stomach. If you just drink cold chilled water, it goes in your stomach and you go on wasting energy just to warm up the water. So don't do that, just warm water with lemon. One thing to be noted here, some people, they are allergic to lemon. Like they create that sourness in the stomach and maybe sometimes they have acidity because of lemon. So for those people, I would suggest you can just take 2 glasses of lemon water, one in the morning, one in the evening. And throughout the day, you can go on drinking just warm water. Those who are allergic, they feel that, because many a times too much of lemon, it causes allergy, it causes acidity in the stomach. So for those people. In between, if you feel like, you can even drink plain water on day two. That's not a problem. Like that lemon, too much of lemon, you feel, oh, I want a glass of plain water. No problem, you can drink plain water. How much lemon water to be consumed? There is no restriction. You can drink as much lemon water as you want. I would say you can get drunk with lemon water. So there's no restriction on quantity. That's day two. And day three, after getting up in the morning, you can start with fresh fruit juices or fresh vegetable juices. Say a glass of it every maybe 2 hours. It's just a guideline. It's not that compulsory that every 2 hours you need to drink the juice. Just a glass of juice around every 2 hours is more than enough. Maybe some people, if you are not hungry, you can drink it after 3 hours. That's not a problem. It's just a guideline that around every 2 hours you need a glass of juice. So of course, with no ice and no sugar, natural fruit juices every 2 hours. And by evening, maybe you can have some soup, some vegetable soup, for example, tomato soup. You just smash the tomato and along with the smashed tomato and the liquid, you just have it. So by evening, dinner time, you can say, a soup, simple soup, vegetable soup, you can have at evening time. So that's the day three. And from day four, you can start with your regular diet. Regular diet doesn't mean that the first thing you get up in the morning and call McDonald's. That's not the regular diet. For a large Domino's pizza, home delivery with extra added cheese, that's not regular diet what I'm talking of. You understood what I mean to say regular diet. So day four is regular diet. Now, what is the whole purpose behind this 3 days of fasting? Day one, we are eating only fruits and vegetables. So as you all are aware, fruits, vegetables, it's large amounts of fiber in it. So that fiber enters in our digestive system. We cannot digest the fiber, so the fiber will remain as it is. And it will work like a natural brush. Every day morning when you get up, you just take the toothpaste and toothbrush and you just clean the teeth with the brush. Every day we do that. Have you ever thought of cleaning up the whole 32 feet long digestive system? Take a brush, put it inside and clean up. Not possible. So this is the natural brush. the fibers which you have consumed on day one, they are all working as a natural brush inside your stomach, inside your small and large intestine. The brush is already inside. Now the second day, what you take inside is the lemon water. Lemon, Ayurveda says, it works like a detergent for your digestive system. It's a cleansing agent, it's a cleaning agent of digestive system. So day two, you have lemon water. So you have the fibers already inside your stomach. Day two, you add the cleaning agent inside your stomach in your digestive system. So you have the brush, you have the cleaning agent. So the fibers will slowly move from the stomach to the small intestine, from the small intestine to the large intestine, and they will actually help you to clean your digestive system. And as you were not eating and drinking large quantities, or you are not having food as such for 2 days, so on day three you drink juices, because juices are good source of energy and you don't need much efforts to digest the juices. So you drink juices on the third day, so you can get energy and at the same time it's less workload on your digestive system. So this process, 3 days of fasting, it can help you to clean your digestive system. It can help you to actually give rest to your digestive system. And then definitely it will help you even up to a certain extent with weight loss, because it's 3 days of fasting. So it will definitely help for weight loss, or I would say improving the metabolism in the body. And every individual with safety can do this. Every individual, like an adult individual, everyone can do this, except for I would not suggest this during pregnancy maybe, and a person having diabetes. So for those two conditions, maybe I would say you may not do it, but then all other people having any kind of problems, any kind of trouble, and even healthy persons, they can do it just to keep their health to that level. And the frequency or the repetition, I would say it can be once in 15 days, but then it depends on your capacity. So once in 15 days, maybe once in 1 month, but it should be done on a regular basis. It's not that you do it once in a while and then after 2 or 3 months you remember it and again you do it. There should be a regularity. If you want to get the benefits, there should be a regularity. And another important thing, you can actually continue with your regular routine even though you are fasting. Some people feel, oh, I need to take leave from my office for 3 days because I want to do this fasting. No need of that. You can go to your office, you can carry out your daily work. Just don't overexert yourselves. Or I can suggest you can do this on your weekends. For example, Saturday, Sunday and Monday. Like Saturday you can go for fruits. Sunday you are at home most probably, so you can just go for lemon water. You can rest at your home on Sunday, drink lemon water. And Monday you can go to the office, maybe you can make some arrangements to get fruit juices, fresh fruit juices, or fresh vegetable juices. You can manage it for Monday. So you can continue with your daily routine even though you are doing this fasting. And as far as the yoga practice is concerned, the traditional yoga practice, this what we are doing here, 1 hour of yoga practice is definitely not a problem, not a trouble. You can go for that, or you can go for more of meditation and relaxation on these 3 days. So that's how you can take care of your digestive system with the food or with this fasting process. So hopefully it's clear for you, the digestive system and a few things what we discussed. We'll stop here. Hari Om.